Again, I think last time when we started the war, I told you about how war in itself will not be tested so much by the College Board. But in the Civil War, there are actually a couple of battles which the College Board does have a tendency to ask about. Not necessarily about what happened on the battlefield, but what happened in society, what happened in the overall war because of that. So one of those was the Battle of Antietam we talked about last time. Battle of Antietam is considered important because it set up the Emancipation Proclamation. The second big change thing is the Battle of Gettysburg. Okay, so the Battle of Gettysburg is, if Antietam made it so that the focus of the war changes, Gettysburg basically changes the real direction, whether or not the Union is going to win or not. So, very, very quickly as far as background. After Antietam, we talked about McClellan getting fired. Well, so now everybody imagine you're Abraham Lincoln and you're trying to figure out who is gonna be your leader. You gotta have a military leader. And the problem is the South had all the good ones. And in the North, you basically had the people who were like not as good in military school, and mixed in with them were the people we call the political generals, who basically worked their way up through the ranks because they had friends in Congress. And so I almost imagine that Abraham Lincoln, as the way he chose his generals, I always imagine, remember the game Twister? So in the game Twister, the big spinner that says what color, you're supposed to put your hand or foot or nose on or something like that. I always imagined Abraham Lincoln having this big spinner in the Oval Office with all the faces of the generals on it. And his way of choosing who was going to come up next was basically going Ambrose Burnside, come on down. It is your turn to play General of the Army of the Potomac. Okay, so the Army of the Potomac, yeah.
Isn't that where the term like sideburns comes from?
It is exactly where the sideburns comes from. Is he had these big mutton chop hairy things on the side of his face. Okay, and so people started calling them Burnsides. Now we call them sideburns. Okay, anyway. Ambrose Burnside replaces McClellan, and when he's told, okay, you're in charge, he said, I don't think I'm going to be a very good general. I think this is above my abilities. And he basically turned out to be absolutely right. He gets absolutely slaughtered at the Battle of Fredericksburg. And so Abraham Lincoln goes back to his spinner and once again goes Thomas Hooker. Now Thomas Hooker likes to surround himself with lovely young ladies. They sometimes called them Hooker's girls. Later they just simply called them hookers. Okay? Thomas Hooker will face General Lee at the Battle of Chancellorsville. And he too will be slaughtered. The one thing that does happen in the Union's favor, however, in this battle, is that after the battle, Thomas Jackson is, Southern General Thomas Jackson, Stonewall Jackson, was returning from patrolling the lines. And there was a confusion. We're not sure if it was because he didn't know the password. We don't know if it was that his soldiers were just nervous. But when he came back to his own lines, his own guys shoot him. Okay? All right? So much for being the Stonewall was right. Robert E. Lee said, I've lost my right arm. The guy who was always there to help Lee turn a battle around was Thomas Jackson and the Stonewall Brigade. That person is gone. Abraham Lincoln is now going to go back to that spinner again. And he comes up this time with a guy by the name of George Meade. Now Meade, no, it's not the paper company. Nothing we can tell you about Meade. But Meade is now put in charge of the Union Army. Just as Meade is put in command, Robert E. Lee decides that he wants to go on the offensive again. Now remember, the last time he had gone on the offensive was when he struck up into Maryland, and it was the one time he had actually been beaten. He had been beaten by McClellan in that bloodbath at Antietam. Now the reason why Lee is going on the offensive, there basically there was a peace movement in the North. It was particularly here in on the Ohio River. They used to call it the Butternut Region. And what the people in that region were very upset about the Civil War, because they were used to using the Ohio River as a way of transporting their goods down to the Mississippi, and then down the Mississippi through New Orleans, and then up to the coast. Well, the problem is that since the Civil War is in place, they can't use the Mississippi River. And it's basically leading to hard times. They can't sell as much of their crops, they're not making the money, and they're unhappy. And so this region, they had elected an anti-war governor in Ohio. There was a lot of pressure to negotiate an end of the Civil War. And if you negotiate an end of the Civil War, it meant that the South had won, because there would be a South country. A negotiated settlement meant the South would exist. And basically what Lee is hoping for is that if he wins, it will strengthen this peace movement, and it might lead to Britain or France not joining the South, but going to the North and saying, you need to negotiate. And if they stuck their nose in, and they said to the North that they needed to negotiate, that was bad news. That was very bad news for the North. Anyway, so Lee starts marching his troops up into Pennsylvania. And he ends up near a little town called Gettysburg. And at Gettysburg, he will face some 92,000 men as far as Meade is concerned, compared to his 76,000 men. Now, when he got there, it's all wrong. And, you know, because if you were about to fight a battle, okay, you've all played the game, right? King of the Mountain? Okay? What position do you want in King of the Mountain? You want the top. Meade had the top. And basically, it would be up to Lee to dislodge Meade from the hillsides. So basically, Meade got the better position. Now, a lot of historians go, why on earth did this turn out to be the place of the battle? Why would Lee have ended up in this position where he's going to fight a battle in which he does not control? Okay? Well, there are two theories. Theory number one is the shoe theory. Okay? And what the shoe theory is that the rebels had intercepted a communique that there was going to be a shipment of shoes going into Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. And you have to realize that the Confederacy, very low on supplies, these soldiers were basically marching their way through their shoes. Okay? They basically had destroyed the soles of their shoes, and they did not have replacements. And so hearing about a possible of shoes was huge. And so the way the story goes is that a detachment of Confederates end up in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, trying to find the shoes. They run into a patrol of Union soldiers, and voila, Battle of Gettysburg. The problem with the shoe theory is it doesn't explain why they are near Gettysburg to begin with. And that's why historians go with the road theory. And if you looked at an aerial map of central Pennsylvania, you'd see that there are 8 major thoroughfares. And for some reason, because of the way the hillsides go, the way that the terrain of Pennsylvania in that center area go, all these roads basically kind of bend and shift and end up by Gettysburg. So no matter what of these 8 roads you took, you ended up near Gettysburg. Anyway, the battle begins, and it's a 3-day seesaw. It's a 3-day seesaw. Basically, whenever you checked in on these battles, you could basically go, who's winning? We're not sure. There were battles within battles. There was a battle called the Battle of Little Round Top, where the Union had control of this tiny little hill, but the Confederacy wanted it because if they got control of this little hill, they could see the entire rest of the battlefield, and they could basically redirect all their forces. As it turned out, holding onto this hill turned out to be pivotal for the Union Army. Okay, they didn't really know it at the time. It finally comes down to the 3rd day. And Lee is going to order an ultimate assault on the Union positions. We call it Pickett's Charge. General George Pickett is told, attack, okay, front on assault, the Union positions. Well, this assault ends up being a complete failure. And historians, once again, they argue why Pickett's Charge is such a failure. And what they have come to a conclusion is, ironically, fences. Get it?
Okay.
Anyway, and it's not about where fences were. It's where fences were not. So everybody imagine, okay, pretend the hat's gray. Okay, and we'll put it backwards for Confederacy. Okay, so you are a Confederate soldier, okay, and you're running toward a fence. Now the fence is low, okay, so any halfway decent person can do the hop, right? But here is the thing. In the 3 days of the battle, many of the fences were knocked over. And so what would happen is you'd have fence, break and fence. Fence, break and fence. Fence, break and fence. And what ended up happening was that the Confederate soldiers, okay, you're running toward the fence, right? And even if you know, you could hop this fence. What is our nature as human beings? What's that? Take the easier way. And so what ends up happening is the soldiers were going toward the fence, but then there was this break in the fence, and they'd all shift toward the breaks. So then imagine you are, okay, the Union, and you are on top of the hill, okay? Where are you going to be concentrating your firing?
The break in the fence.
At the breaks in the fence.
Like, if they had all hopped the fence, it would have been spread out.
It would have been spread out. It may or may not have failed. We don't know what would have happened because they could have overrun the hill. We don't know. What we do know is they didn't. And this is one of the better explanations as to why this charge, this order by Lee, this genius Lee, turns out to be such a failure. In retrospect, we now know that this is basically that moment. Now, obviously, they couldn't have known, oh, it's all over, okay? But it's basically this. You've got battle after battle after battle, the Union being defeated, Lee winning. And then there's this one. And everything before it seemed to be going the Confederates' way. After, not so much. So we basically believe that this is what broke the back of the Confederacy.
So did Meade's men already just happen to be in Gettysburg, or how did that?
So it was based. It was the same thing. As forces are coming northward, your spies and whatnot are saying, "Okay, they're coming north, okay, so we're going to go south." And again, roads.
Right. Okay.
You're moving south. They're moving north. The roads all bend. Boom. Hi!
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Anyway, there's one last thing that still needs to be dealt with, however. Yeah?
Was the Battle of Gettysburg considered the first real victory for the Union, or was that?
Antietam is considered to be the first real victory, then, despite the bloodbathedness of it.
And then, so Battle of Gettysburg at the
century? Yeah.
Okay.
And when I say first, I'm talking the main army. The main thing that was happening is if you were going, where's the main front of the war? It was the front where Robert E. Lee was fighting. There were, however, other victories on the other front. We'll call it the Western Front. And we're going to go visit the Western Front right now, because the Western Front is going to help answer us a final question. Where do you get a general who's truly going to take advantage of the fact that you have more men, more resources? Who's going to fight in a way that can truly beat Robert E. Lee? Meade did it in this battle, but it was a little bit more luck than strategy. So the second thing, finding a general, we go to the West. Okay? And in the West, ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce to you, okay, Ulysses S. Grant. Now that's actually not his birth name. His birth name was actually Hiram Ulysses Grant. Okay. It was one of those families in which mom and dad did not quite agree as to the name of the child. And so daddy always called him Hiram, but mama always called him Ulysses. And well, it's going to be mama's contacts, her connections, which helped get Hiram Ulysses into West Point. And when he gets to West Point, there on the roll books, it's not Hiram Ulysses Grant, it's Ulysses S. Grant. Now that's interesting because Ulysses Grant had no idea where the S came from. And so eventually he decided that it was his mom's maiden name, Simpson. And so he basically gets himself renamed by West Point. And we now know him as Ulysses Simpson Grant, or U.S. Grant, U.S., okay? Anyway, now Grant, however, is a flawed individual, a very flawed individual. He had tried to become, he had gone through college, at the military academy, not the first in his class, okay? Near the back of the class, okay? He really was only good at two things at the military academy. He was really good at riding horses, and he's really good at math, okay? He was an amazing mathematician, and his dream was to come back to the military academy and teach math. He wanted to be Dr. No, okay? He wanted to be a math teacher. Now, he fought in the Spanish, in the Mexican-American War, and his position there was a quartermaster, which, by the way, turns out to be something good for math because it's keeping track of stuff. Anyway, it was there in this war that something starts to emerge. Ulysses Grant did not drink a drop until he did. And when he did, he went all out. Okay? He was a binge drinker. He was the guy who basically drank until he's passed out drink guy. And now, fortunately for him, he had friends who basically covered for him. Made it so that he could get away with this, and even in the military. But after the war, he was stationed up in Oregon, okay? And in Oregon, it was cold, wet, and rainy. And his wife, Julia, thought, I don't so much want to hang out in cold, wet, rainland. So she, while he was stationed in Oregon, went to live with her family in Kentucky, leaving Ulysses Grant in cold, wet, rainy, and alone. So he drank more, and he got caught, and he got kicked out of the army. When the Civil War comes around, he had been basically having a real tough life. He tried to be a farmer, he lost the farm. He tried running a hardware store, he lost the hardware store. Finally, his daddy felt sorry for him and gave him a job in the tanner business, making leather for the, with the rest of the family. When some war came about, he decided, maybe this is my chance for redemption. Maybe I can come back and be a soldier again. Yeah. We're not sure. We also think he's just not the greatest businessman. He's not the greatest farmer. But we're gonna find his skill in men. Okay. Yeah. Hold that idea. All right. Anyway. When he tried to get back into the army, they rejected it. He was a drinker. And finally, it took his mom's connections once again, and they basically put him in charge of a volunteer unit. and all of a sudden, he found his thing. He can't run a farm, can't run a store, but you fire cannonballs over this guy's head, and he goes all genius. He was one of those people that right in the middle of a battle knew exactly what to do. Now, you ever know those people that like crisis over is running this craziness and then they're just in there calmly going, okay, this is what you should do. Did anyone know any of those people? This is Ulysses Grant. Okay? When it's calm, he's useless. But when it's crazy, all of a sudden, he's calm. Okay. Anyway, so he starts to show that he can run an army, and he starts to get promoted. And as the promotions were going out, they kept trying to tell Abraham Lincoln not to sign off on them, saying, this guy is a drinker, don't do it. And Abraham Lincoln said a couple jokes, he's a jokester. And first thing he said is, I like this man, he fights. But the next thing he says is that, find out what he's drinking and give it to my other generals. Okay. His rise happens in Tennessee, where he captures two forts, Fort Henry and Fort Donelson. It's Fort Donelson, which was the truly amazing one. Fort Donelson was one of those forts which the Union had had very little success in taking. And when Grant saw it, he immediately saw a plan. You see, when he got to Fort Donelson, it was right after a huge rainstorm, and he noticed that the river was running high. And he looks out on the river, and he goes, well, let's position our gunboats out there on the river. And what he had noticed was that the river was running so high that the gunboats were up a higher level than they normally would be. They could fire their guns straight into the fort. Matt will help you with me. Okay. Anyway. He's given a higher level of authority, a higher command. But he nearly loses all of the gains he made at a battle called Shiloh. What happened at Shiloh is on the first day of the battle, the Confederates whooped him. What Grant showed that he was different.
Thank you.
What Grant showed that he was different was rather than retreat after losing the first day, he went down to the field and repositioned his army. And on the second day, he won. Now, after the battle, you basically ended up with two separate camps on who Grant is. You had the camp of this guy can winner, and then you had the other guy who basically were looking at the body count. That he wins, but a lot of people die. And this is something that Lincoln was being apprised of. But Lincoln was also just simply seeing the W's, where he wasn't seeing them before. Finally, Grant will show his grasp of strategy, his planning, by laying siege to the last Confederate stronghold on the Mississippi River, Vicksburg. And after 7 weeks, where he surrounds this fort, forces the people inside to burrow into the mountainside to take cover, to eat their mules and rats in order to survive, and finally, on the 4th of July, 1863, they surrender to Grant. Now, coincidentally, that's the very same weekend as the Battle of Gettysburg.
So over here in the west, on the Mississippi River, okay, Grant just took Vicksburg. In the east, okay, Gettysburg, Meade had defeated Lee. The victory, Gettysburg, GB, basically will battle had a unit off in reserve that would come riding in and turn the tide. Grant thought that was kind of ridiculous. There should be no Confederate army that does not have a Union army to confront it. And basically what the strategy was, to attack all the enemy armies at once, make sure that every single unit of the Confederacy is engaged at the same time, so they could not reinforce one another. He then methodically fights Lee. He will win battle after battle, but the basic thing is that he was trained about 2-1, okay, with two Union soldiers for every Confederate death in the battles of Cold Harbor, Spotsylvania, and the Woodlands. And here's the thing. Even though the Union was taking more losses, guess who was losing a larger percentage of his army? Confederacy did not have the men to replace them. And even though bigger losses for the Union, greater loss to the whole for the Confederacy. Their army is getting smaller and smaller and smaller. So again, you've got people out there. Some people are saying, woohoo, we're winning. Other people are going, oh. To reduce men's power, Lee is everybody knows that the thing that was holding the Confederacy together was Robert E. Lee. And Robert E. Lee has surrendered. In Washington, D.C., there's celebration. Many people were for him to turn around and say, let's do this nicely. But you can't say, well, you're a weakling, because he had just fought a war. Not very many people have that reputation to be able to hold themselves.
Yeah,
there's Walt Whitman, who I believe gives the best ode to Abraham Lincoln. So while you look at what finally, truly, truly ends the Civil War, I'd like to read to you a captain my captain. Oh, captain, my captain, our fearful trip is done. The ship has weathered every rack, the prize we sought. The port is near, the bells I hear, the people all exulting, while follow eyes the steady keel, the vessel grim and daring. But oh heart, 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 oh bleeding drops of red, where on the deck my captain lies, fallen cold and dead. Oh captain, my captain, rise up, hear the bells. Rise up, for you the flag is flung. For you the bugle trills, for you bouquet and ribbon wreath. For you, the shores crowded. For you, they call the swaying mass, their eager faces turning. Your captain, your father, this arm beneath your head. It is some dream that on the deck you fall and fall dead. My captain does not answer. His lips are pale and steel. My father does not feel my arm. He has no pulse or will. The ship is anchored safe and sound. The voyage floats in the dark. From fearful trip, the victor ship comes in with object one. Exalt, O shores, and ring, O bells, but I with mournful tread